Hello and welcome to the DFS Coach Talk podcast. Today is Monday, April 6th, and I am Joe Sarvati, affectionately known as Coach, and I am joined by one of our most valuable assets to the DFS Coach Talk team. It is Mr. Layton Wilson. How are you today, Layton?
I'm doing good, Coach. Thanks for the awesome introduction there.
And well deserved, my friend. So we're starting off another week, another COVID-19 lockdown week. I know for you it's been a little bit different because you've still been able to get out and work and do your sort of regular stuff where, you know, being part of that team that's, I guess, considered a necessary work environment is better than being locked down, I would think.
Yeah, I mean, it hasn't been too bad. This past Friday, we actually just got our essential employee papers. So we had to put those in our windshield. And I know Missouri, here where I live, is doing the stay-at-home act or whatever it's called, and basically trying to get people to stay home unless absolutely, you know, necessary that they need to get out. So, yeah, I mean, it's going to be different around here for sure. Even in the small town I live in, it's starting to, you know, be even more quiet than it usually is. But like I said, I'm just taking it day by day, just like everybody else, and doing what we can.
Yeah, that's all we can do. It still is surreal at times, though. Every once in a while, you sort of forget about the situation. It's like, man, I mean, it's just like you would see in a movie. You know, people can't get out, and you have to have information on your windshield to go by to be out of your house. It's like, what the heck? Craziness. And I don't know if you listened to yesterday's show with podcast with Santino and I, but we talked a little bit about, you know, the different scenarios of possibilities of when they come back and what it's going to look like. You know, there's been some different pieces of information out there of people saying they may just all play in Vegas and lock down in a hotel and then play on the two sites that they usually play, the NBA Summer League, because they're both connected there. You can easily get from one to the other. There's all kinds of things and options that the NBA is looking at, but who knows at this point? I mean, nobody knows anything. So that's what makes it so bizarre for all of you out there that are sort of control freaks like me, that like the calendar set and everything, you know, normal and set up and done. And it's like, this is way, way outside my comfort zone. That's for sure.
Oh yeah, for sure. It's like I said, it's definitely different. And I believe I saw something the other day where President Trump was actually supposed to talk to all the commissioners of the sports that are supposed to be going on right now.
He did. And they did I watched SportsCenter last night. They talked about that meeting and really didn't say much of anything other than the fact that he did tell them, you know, we know you got to get back as soon as possible. We're going to push to get this back as quickly as we can when it's, you know, safe to do so. And just the regular mumbo jumbo like that. But basically the commissioners, I guess, were talking amongst themselves about different ideas of, doesn't sound like any of them are going to be playing with fans anytime in the near future on any of the sports. But trying to determine, I think, the next step for all the leagues is, you know, do we play in one venue and not try to travel as much for the teams that play like almost every day, like baseball, basketball, that kind of stuff. For football, it probably wouldn't be as bad, and I'm not sure even hockey, but I don't know. There's going to be a lot of weird options out there, and I think, you know, we're going to see some interesting stuff that we've never seen before, but that's where sort of we are now. So I guess that'll just go on with the theme, you know. But I can't imagine watching an NBA playoff game with no fans. That's going to really hurt.
Oh, yeah. I mean, LeBron's commented on it plenty of times that he doesn't want to play without fans because there's really no point in it. But, I mean, like you said, with people that play better on the at home or better on the road, you know, it's going to be something where you have to really look into that, I guess, if you're a team of that nature, and see how that's going to work out for you.
No doubt about it. And, you know, we're still, you know, as you know, and we say it every podcast, but, you know, our goal here is to prepare for when DFS comes back. As you know, and as all of our listeners know, our focus is not to waste this time with silly stuff. It's, you know, we're breaking down every NBA team, and this is, we only have six teams left, so this is our third to last show, buddy. And then we're on to baseball, which we're going to do the same thing, and then we're going to do the same for football. And we're also going to have, you know, go over some rule differences on each site for each sport, and, you know, contest selection, bankroll management, all the stuff that's going to help you really crush it when DFS comes back. And then it's going to be a blast. We're going to have a mock draft that will go for 4 days for each sport, basketball, baseball, and football. That'll be coming up end of May, beginning of June, if we're not back to sports, where we'll be drafting guys from our experts within the DFS Coach Talk team of players that we think are going to do the best from a DFS standpoint. So we'll be taking the NBA players with the remaining season of the regular season that's left and the playoffs. And then for Major League Baseball and the NFL, we're going to be taking them for regular season DFS points. So it's something, once sports gets back, we can actually keep a tally on and see who had the best mock drafts. I think there may be a couple of side bets on that flying through the ranks. What do you think?
Oh, yeah, exactly. I mean, if it's not you and Mike, it'd probably be you and Andrew, but I think you'll be involved with it either way.
I think so. I think there's going to be some dollars exchanging hands, that's for sure. Well, today, as I say, we're down to the Western Conference counting down from worst to best. So Layton and I today have the sixth place Houston Rockets and the fifth place Oklahoma City Thunder. Both have the identical record of 40-24, but the Thunder hold the tiebreaker against Houston because they're 2-1 against them this season. So, you know, what we've been doing is just slicing and dicing through these teams and talking about what we're anticipating when they come back. Like, there's a lot of guys that had been injured. Now they've had the time to heal up, a lot of stuff like that. Sort of give a, you know, little bit of insight into what we anticipate is going to happen down the stretch. And again, I don't know if you listen, I doubt you've had a chance to listen to yesterday's, or I don't know if you've heard this on some of the things, but did you hear some of the feedback from some of the players and the players NBA association the last couple of days, Layton?
No, I actually haven't got a chance to look at any of that.
Well, it's interesting, and I mentioned it yesterday, but it's something noteworthy enough to mention again, is it's funny because some of the players of the teams that have really already been eliminated, Suns, Timberwolves, Warriors, all kinds of teams like that, that have absolutely no chance, they don't want to play out the rest of the regular season. Because, and I'm not saying all of them. I'm saying some of them have let the Players Association know. Chris Paul's the head of the Players Association. He's brought this forward to Commissioner Silver because they figure, why should we put ourselves and our families at risk to play 12 or 13 games that are meaningless to us because we can't make the playoffs? Whereas if we just were allowed to stay to ourselves until the beginning of next NBA season, then by then we'll probably, you know, have everybody healthy or have an injection to you know, fight it off or whatever it is. But something I wasn't expecting at all. So isn't that interesting?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, obviously, if they were to go with something like that, I mean, there's plenty of matchups between playoff teams and non-playoff teams. So then you dive into, you know, that aspect. What do you do there? Do you just give them a win there and go on from that? And then obviously with seeding, if one team is facing six out of, let's say there's 10 games and they face six out of 10 teams that aren't playing and get six wins automatically, and then a team right behind them only gets four. I mean, you're really, I mean, like you said, this is something we've never even seen before. But the only thing I would say is if this never hit, you know, we'd still continue the season, and, you know, you wouldn't have those players saying a word about that.
I know. It's not something I expected, that's for sure. I know they're all chomping at the bit to play, but I guess with guys like Cat, you know, where both his mother and father have had it, and his I guess his mother's pretty darn sick. It's scary. I'm sure, you know, when it rings that close to home, you know, I'm sure it gives you a little bit different look at it. So it's a sad situation, but it's so, you know, so confusing. Really, nobody knows what's going to happen, to be honest with you. It's, you know, and then the other piece of news that I thought was amazing, because how the hell would that work, is the governor of California, Gavin Newsom, said that he said this right out in the press. You can fact check it. He said that there will not be any NFL games played in his state for the remainder of this year. So, okay. So what the hell happens if the NFL tries to go back, and it's, you know, it's his right to state that. So I guess those teams would have to play their games in other stadiums. I mean, good Lord, man, this is so crazy.
Yeah. I mean, I guess they would have no other choice than to do that. So, again, that's just something I guess we'll see when the time comes, if that's actually a realistic statement, or, you know, depending, I'm guessing, on the situation that we're in now, if it were to, you know, increase and get a lot better trend towards that way, then I would say we'd look at something a lot different than that.
I don't know, man. I guess, you know, I bring these things up, and there's a couple other ones I could even mention too, but it's just, all it does is make things more confusing. Nobody knows what's going to happen. So I guess to try to decide that, you know, it doesn't do us a whole lot of good, because we're just going to be grasping at straws here. You know, obvious, all of us love sports. We want DFS back. We can't wait to get that going. But of course, we also want everybody to be safe and everything else. But, you know, for those guys, I mean, the owners of the teams and the commissioners and stuff, when they're discussing this, yeah, you know, this isn't a game to them. This is billions and billions of dollars, and they've got to figure out, you know, between the politicians, you know, not wanting to play, and players not wanting to play, and all the different dynamics at play here, because who's to say when Dr. Fauci and the CDC and all these guys are going to say it's safe to go back? And then what if they go back and there's a little outbreak again? Do they just shut everything back down? I mean, it's mind-boggling, dude. I don't know. I guess we just take it a day at a time and see where it plays out. But to get back to the point that I wanted to originally make is we're doing our best here. We're going to do a 7-day-a-week podcast no matter what. I'm actually sitting on my porch right now, so if you hear any birds or my dog going in and out, that's what's going on. But we're going to be live, bringing this information to you every day, breaking down teams, figuring out every advantage we can get. And we're going to utilize that the day that DFS starts and crush it. I know I say that all the time, but that's what we're going to do, man. And speaking of crushing it, why don't you start in with the team that everybody wanted to get, because they're a fun team to talk about, the small ball Houston Rockets. So give us some big info that we can take with us until the Rockets get back out on the court.
Yeah, Coach, let's dive right into this. To first of all, to touch on it, you already touched that they had a 40-24 record tied with the Oklahoma City Thunder, who you'll be touching on here in a little bit. That puts them first in the Southwest Division, a game and a half ahead of Dallas. So Dallas is in that second place spot there in the Southwest. I broke down their home and away. They're 22-10 at home, and 18-14 away. And then their last 10, normal. They've been Last 10, they've been 6-4. So I think a big thing I want to touch on first is, 40-24 is not a bad record, but I think a lot of people saw, the Rockets as a more of a threat in the West than just, kind of the middle of the pack kind of team.
Obviously, well,
they're going to make
though,
the
man,
playoffs.
But. Do you remember like 15 games into the season? They were like 6-9. People were freaking out like they were going to be terrible. So they did start really bad. And considering 16 games over 500 and this small ball experiment, they've been pretty damn good.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, they've definitely played a lot better later this season and probably, the last couple months before this shutdown happened because of that change that they made. And we'll touch on that a little bit more later. But basically what I want to do is dive straight into the DFS side of it and kind of touch on that and where the usage goes and all those good stats there. I actually have a question for you, Coach, after this.
Okay. Uh-oh. All right.
Yeah, you're always quizzing me, so I thought I'd come back at you. But
I'm always ready for a quiz.
So James Harden, right, he leads the usage rate at 36.4. Westbrook is right behind him, 2 points behind him at 34.4. Who is...
Those are both fantastic numbers, by the way. I mean, those are worthy of the spending the big bucks to take those guys. That's for damn sure.
Exactly. Yeah. Now, my question for you is, who is the third and fourth in usage for the Houston Rockets?
We're talking about regular players, not just like goofy, they don't play but a couple of games kind of guys?
I cannot answer that.
Wow. All right. I would say that Eric Gordon would be the most common sense pick. Am I right or wrong with him?
He's in fifth.
Okay. See, I've got a feeling these are going to be kooky guys just because of the quiz. So I'm going to dig down deep here and try to come up with quirky guys that come in that don't play much or were up and down from the G League that shoot the ball. So they have a lot of usage. I am going to throw out Chris Clemens.
Chris Clemens is in third at 24% usage rate.
No shit. I should win at least $5 for that guess. That is a great guess.
That is.
This last guy. Oh, shucks, man. I don't know. I really don't know, so I'll just say Ben McLemore.
He is down at 7 with 15.6. In fourth is Ryan Anderson, who's not even playing basketball anymore.
Oh, for crying out loud. That's beyond a trick question. Now you owe me $10 instead of $5.
No,
so
I
did get Eric Gordon, who's fifth, you said?
He's fifth, and then you got Chris Clemens at
Clemens.
3.
Hey, I'll take that. I'm proud of that effort, I guess. But I would have guessed 100 guys before I guessed stinking Ryan Anderson, that's for sure.
No, exactly. And, I mean, that's the point I was trying to reach. That is crazy how you have Westbrook at 36.4 – or, sorry, Harden at 36.4, Westbrook at 34.4. And then after that, the two guys immediately after him, one's not playing basketball anymore, and one has been going back and forth from the G League all year. And then these guys that you have that actually put, legit minutes in there, you got, like I said, Eric Gordon in fifth at 22.1, Ben McLemore at 15.6 in seventh. Then you got Austin Rivers at 14.8 in ninth. And then other than that, I mean, you have your guys like Sabolosha or Cephalosha and PJ Tucker that – barely go above a 10% usage rate.
Oh, my gosh. Well, see, this is a perfect example of how meaningful this is. Everybody knows that Harden and Westbrook are ridiculous. So, which from what you said, that's like 71% usage combined for those two guys. That's unbelievable. There can't be another team with two guys combining for that high, I guarantee it. But what it does say is, because Houston plays at a quick pace, all of us suckers that have been trying to slide in Gordon, McLemore, Rivers, Hartenstein, House, Cephalosha, PJ Tucker. These guys are all not good DFS players. And I think they get forced in to lineups just because they're part of the Rockets, and that could be a big mistake.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, and the point I really wanted to make with this is those guys are prevalent if one or two of them are out, meaning Harden or Westbrook are out.
Oh,
that's
gotcha.
The only time they would be prevalent. I mean, because you're talking about a third of the usage opening up. So
well, more than
kinda,
that. Yeah. 30%. That's it. Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, that's, to me, that's insane. And like you said, if you were to look into all these other teams that we've covered, you probably wouldn't see that same scenario. So that's just, that's crazy how dependent they are on those two guys.
Yeah, that's a challenge to our listeners out there. If anybody can find two guys that combine for over 70% usage on the same team, send it to us on Twitter, because I am, without knowing it, I can't believe there's another team. Because you very rarely have a guy, you know, in the 30s, like mid-30s, 35%, just one guy on a team that high, let alone two. That's unheard of.
Yeah, exactly. And, I mean, obviously, we'll dive into Harden here a little bit. He had that real rough stretch there for a while, and, you know, people were constantly taking Westbrook to kind of fill in that spot there, because his usage kept climbing and climbing because, you know, Harden was struggling. And me and you have had the conversation before. You know, Harden's the type of guy, a lot of people take him for a greedy guy, but he's the type of guy, if he gets doubled or if he's not having a good game, he'll start dishing it out and he'll start moving the ball.
Well, you know, the big thing that's huge is knowing the teams that double the ball, because teams like Toronto and Dallas and the Lakers did a little bit. They will run a double right at James Harden as soon as he crosses half court, forcing him to immediately give up the ball. And like you said, he doesn't force it between – if he sees two guys, he's confident enough in his team that he's going to kick it and let them play 4-on-3, which is the way to do it. But what you don't want to have Harden in a game like that where he's just giving up the ball, because he's not even getting the assist most of the time. They're just playing 4-on-3 and then, you know – it falls from there. So that's the only concern with Harden is he going to get doubled like that? And when he does, I mean, you got to be a fool not to roster Westbrook, because, you know, his 35-36% usage is going to shoot over 40 in a game like that.
Yeah, exactly. I'm like you said, I know you guys have touched on that multiple times throughout the podcast during the season, because, I mean, like I said, Harden was going through that tough stretch. Everybody was giving him a hard time, but this is really what I wanted to touch on. He's still first in scoring in the league.
Yeah.
He's first in three-pointers made by over 30 shots. The next closest is Buddy Hield.
Yeah.
And he's also second in fantasy point average this season.
And he's a billion ahead in free throws attempted and free throws made, too. Like, ridiculously ahead. It's just – he's – possibly, I'd say it's like almost tied for me between Giannis and him as the single best guy to roster. I know that a little tiny bit of the luster has come off having Westbrook next to him, but like you just stated in those stats, he's still just absolutely ridiculous.
Yeah, and then I know, you know, we've touched on this before, Coach. You know, when it comes to Giannis, his minutes get cut because they'll be blowing teams out, and the Rockets, you know, haven't been the exact team that everybody thought they are. And D'Antoni, he'll play them 35, 40 minutes, whether they're beating a team by 20 or losing by 20. So I would go to say that if you were trying to, you know, pick between a guy like Harden and Giannis, I would say, you know, judging on the matchup, probably go with Harden.
Well, you know, I generally would say that because I'm more lean towards the money minutes equal money scenario, and Harden definitely averages a lot more minutes than Giannis. But I will say this in Giannis's defense: if the season ended now and they didn't play any more games, he would break the DFS record for these like 5 or 6 years that DFS has been around for points. DFS points per minutes played No one's ever been to at the number he's at right now. So I'll throw the quiz back to you. Do you know what that number is? Points per minute played for Giannis this season, which would be the highest in the history of DFS for the NBA.
You're talking about fantasy points, I'm guessing?
Fantasy points per minute played, yes.
Per minute, I'm going to guess 2.1.
2.3, good guess. You stayed under, too. So he's at 2.33. So that, when you think about it, that's ludicrous, dude. I mean, I'd be happy to roster an entire team at 1.3 per minute. You know, so the fact that he's at that 2.3 number, to me, makes that even to the exact point you just made about Harden. He does get blowout minutes and a lot more minutes and so many foul shots. And even though Giannis is bad from three and bad from the foul line, he's still getting 2.3. Can you imagine when he starts hitting 30-32% of his threes and starts shooting 75-78% from the foul line? He's going to be, I mean, so much the best. It's not even funny. But he's not there yet. He's not there yet.
Oh, yeah, exactly. And, I mean, people tend to forget a lot about some of these players. I mean, some of these guys are still in their mid-20s and have a lot of room to grow. And you just kind of forget about that.
Yeah, some of them are teenagers, for God's sakes. The Zions. Luka just turned 20 or 21, I don't know. But something like stupid like that. So it's just craziness, man.
Yeah, but we'll dive back into here. But yeah, I mean, like I said, my point was, you know, Westbrook is also, I mean, Westbrook is Westbrook. He's a freak. So yeah. I believe Santino was talking about this the other day. Westbrook, I mean, you're talking top five athletic guys in the league today, if not ever.
Yeah, no doubt.
The guy is an absolute freak. And
I've never seen, I mentioned it, I think, on that podcast you're talking about. I've never seen anybody with a motor like his. I'm talking anybody, Michael Jordan, Kobe, anybody. I think he plays harder every second he's out on the floor than any player in league history, in my opinion. That's a big statement.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I mean, especially you're talking about in the history of the game too, just in present. So
now, and I've been following this game very closely for a lot of years, and the intensity that he takes out onto the floor, unmatched. I don't know how he does it, and he's been doing it for quite a long time now. It's not like he's 22 or 24. I mean, what is he, like 30, 31? He's getting there. He's not, you know, he's been doing this for a long time.
Yeah, exactly. A lot of guys, you know, those, you'll see them start to change their game when they get to that point. And, you know, he really hasn't. He's still a slasher. Nope. And, you know, we touched on the small ball aspect they went to. And I really think offensively, you know, their numbers are already great. I believe they're second in offensive efficiency in the league a team.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, when you're talking about a small ball kind of team, literally everybody on the court can shoot a three and you're going five wide. There's nobody in the paint. You're letting Westbrook blow past that guy and he's going straight to the rack every time.
Well, I guarantee you none of the teams are excited to play Houston in the playoffs. When you have a 1-2 punch like that, that's tough. I don't care if you're the Lakers or the Clippers. That's tough. Excuse me.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I was kind of.
That was so good, it choked me up, man. I had to get a drink.
Oh, Lord. But, yeah, I mean, like I said, they're second in offensive efficiency, 16th in defense efficiency, so kind of right in the middle of a pack there. A stat that probably wouldn't shake too many people up, they're second to last in assist percentage.
Wow. Well, because Harden, a lot of times, if they're not doubling him, he just dribbles the ball like 17, 18 times before he goes to the bucket, and nobody else is touching it. So,
yeah, it's the same thing with Westbrook. There's a lot of isolation, a lot of one-on-one game that they play. Yeah. And then those guys usually get it, you know, on the kick out or had to work for a rebound. But to follow on the rebound side of it, in almost any rebounding category, offensive rebounding, defensive rebounding, or overall, they're bottom third of the league.
Yeah.
Which
well,
is
they
not
don't have
surprising.
they don't use any fours or fives. They have a lineup of 2-1s, a 2 and 2-3s. I mean, how the hell are you gonna? I don't know how they're doing it as is, you know, rebounding wise. It's amazing.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you got what, 6'5" PJ Tucker as your center. I mean, that's
If that.
no matter how scrappy that guy is, when you have all those big guys out in the West, you know, that would be my main concern with them. Just to kind of lead into this playoff race. I mean, you're talking about Clippers who have Montrezl Harrell, Zubac, I mean, Kawhi even. Then you're talking about the Lakers who have McGee, Davis, Howard. The Nuggets have Jokic and Grant and Millsap. I mean, all these fours and fives are all over spread across the West. And we're not talking about slouches. We're talking about top 25 players in the league.
Good bigs. Yeah. That's going to be tough. I mean, they've beaten some of those teams in the few weeks up to the stoppage. So it can be done. But as you know, when the playoffs come around, everything slows down. Everything, every rebound is tougher. Every defensive possession is tougher. I find it hard to understand how they're going to hang in there against the Davises and Jokic's and all those guys. That's going to be tough, man.
Yeah, exactly. Truthfully, it's just going to take Westbrook and Harden absolutely just demolishing all of the playoffs, and that's the bottom line. When you look at the team leaders here for the Rockets, you have, of course, Harden with 34.4 points a game. You have Westbrook, your point guard, leading with 8 rebounds. You have James Harden, 7.4 assists. James Harden with 1.7 steals. And James Harden even leads in blocks with
0.9. James Harden does?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
That's incredible.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's why, I mean, I was trying to really prove that point or drive it home. I mean, that's how reliant they are on these guys to perform. And a lot of people probably don't know that. They, you know, kind of just look at it as, oh, it's James Harden. Oh, it's Westbrook. No, I mean, they simply believe or simply rely on these guys in almost every aspect of the game.
Let me ask you this. Is there anybody else rostering on their team in any consistent type of format whatsoever? Now, I know myself speaking, I look at these lineups that people are producing, and it amazes me how many times there's PJ Tucker that at 12% usage, or Robert Covington, who's been pretty good with them, or Macklemore. These guys are making people's lineups, but based on that statistical analysis, it almost looks like the Dallas team I talked about yesterday. You take Luka or Porzingis or punt. It's almost like that with Houston to some extent. Although, I mean, Gordon can have a hot game too, so I guess there's a little more leeway with him or Covington, but I don't know. I'm not sure.
Yeah, me and you have touched on Covington quite a bit since he made that move over to Houston, and it's great for him. So I really think, obviously, like you said, just depending on the night, Harden or Westbrook, and if you can get Covington in there with a decent matchup or kind of a filler, that's what I'd go to. And I stand corrected on the blocks, Coach, since Covington has moved over. And then Capella was averaging 1.8. Of course, he's with Atlanta now and hurt. And then I guess they weren't counting Covington's, but since Covington's been there, he's actually averaged 2.5 blocks for them.
Wow. That's a lot. And those stocks that Covington's been getting definitely puts him into play. I mean, I think he's a solid, because his price has remained very reasonable too. That's the other thing. So if it is a perfect matchup for Houston, you know, I think Covington's a reasonable choice. What do you think about Eric Gordon?
To be honest, Coach, I think anybody else on that team is reliant on injuries that happen and usage and minutes opening up for the most part. Unless it's just one of those things where you're trying to make a GPP play, or simply you have, you know, X amount of dollars left and, oh, well, this guy's here. Hopefully he has a nice game. I mean, because I guess that's the thing with them is – you always have Harden and Westbrook. They're 10K plus easily. Harden's usually 11 plus, which that's what gives Westbrook a little edge there sometimes is, you know, he might be around that 10-2 range where Harden's around 11-3. Well, if I can save a grand and go somewhere else with it, I might make that choice. And then, like you touched on, Covington is always around 5 to 6K usually. I think he's not much higher than that.
56 to 61 somewhere in there, I believe.
Yeah, and I mean that's fantastic, especially like I said, to touch on the steals too. He averages over one steal a game, so I mean, he's easily going to give you on FanDuel, obviously with 3 points for a steal or block, he's going to give you 9 points in defense, and that's not to mention he can shoot the three ball. He's going to rebound a little bit there and get it done in other categories too. So I definitely think he's an outlier kind of, but he's definitely there.
He's a stocks kind of guy, especially since he's moved to Houston, because even though they say Tucker's the five and he jumps center, Covington sort of plays the five. He's getting more of those rebounds and blocks, and you know, he can play the two for crying out loud if he needed to. So, yeah, I like him. And as far as Gordon goes, you know how if you ever take something down and a guy just goes like 14X for you, you just always love him? And I had Eric Gordon in a game where Westbrook and Harden were both out, and he had 50 real points for me, and he was like 4,700 because the sites hadn't adjusted his price, and I took something down with him. He was fairly highly owned, but still, I mean, he had like 63 fantasy points at a cheap price, and so I've got a soft spot in my heart for him this year. But you're right. When Harden and Westbrook are out there, I think it's just pretty simple. If Covington is in a good matchup where he's going to get those stocks, that's cool. If not, then you know, it's better not to jam in the Macklemores. And I just, to play like an Austin Rivers or even PJ Tucker to me is just crazy.
Oh, yeah, it's definitely a stretch. But yeah, Coach, if we can, we'll dive into their contract situation a little bit here, and then we'll work our way to the Thunder. But
they have a big payroll there. I know that.
Yeah, so obviously you have Westbrook and Harden, they average around $40 million a year.
That's all.
Yeah, up till 22-23 season. So obviously they had those two guys locked down there, and obviously that's for the most part through their prime, being Westbrook's 31, Harden's 30. So I mean, I guess that's a good situation for them. But you're also talking about over those next 3 or 4 years, that's $250 million locked up in two guys.
Wow.
Yeah, so that's definitely seems a little steep when you look at it that way.
Yeah, they're worth it, though, that's for sure. If in all, you know, when you look at the whole picture, I guess, yeah, at least they get it done, that's for sure. There's guys making big bucks that don't, so I guess those guys deserve it.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I mean, that actually takes me back to back when they bumped up the cap room, you know, quite a bit back in the day. Who was it for Memphis? Oh, Mike Conley got that huge max contract and gets injured the next year, and I don't even know if he's playing basketball anywhere anymore.
So, yeah, he's still playing with the Jazz. He's been playing decent, actually, before the break. But you're right. I mean, you know, if you give those guys the contract at the wrong time, you can get stung. I mean, Conley's a superstar compared to some of the guys. I remember, who's the guy for the Grizzlies? The real handsome kid, played for the Mavericks and Rockets. And then he's barely ever played. He's on the Grizzlies now, and he may have retired. Do you know who I'm talking about? I'll think of it.
It must have been...
I'll think of it.
Pretty low there.
It was unbelievable the money he made and never really played. So, yeah, it's pretty
crazy.
Yeah, I
mean, I guess that's the business part about it. It's always a risk. And, you know, kind of going back to what we talked about earlier, you're kind of diving into the aspect of the business and what they're missing out on right now and what they have to protect. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that goes into this in general, you know, without what we have going on right now. But to dive back into the contracts, third on the team is Eric Gordon, who we touched on. He's locked down for an average of about $17 million a year for the next 5 years to the 23-24 season. Wow. And then obviously they just got Covington in that trade. He's on a pretty good contract at an average about $12 million for the next 3 years. So that's a great move for them. Tyson Chandler, Cephalosha, Bruno Caboclo.
Caboclo.
Damari Carroll and Jeff Green. All those names right there will be free agents after this season. So obviously that's going to free up a little cap for them, and they're going to have to make some moves there. I don't necessarily think they're going to be going after any, you know, big free agents or anything like that with the money wrapped up in Harden and Westbrook, but they can definitely snag a couple, you know, veterans to help fill that bench out a little bit more.
Sure.
Daniel House and PJ Tucker. Daniel House averages about $3.5 million a year for the next three, and PJ Tucker is at about $8 million a year for the next two. Obviously, House, I think he's actually turned into a solid little role player this year.
Yeah.
He fits that spot there really well. He can shoot the ball. He's kind of a scrappy guy, and I think he found a pretty good home there in Houston. And obviously, at a contract like that, if you can get a solid role player out of that, I mean, you'd love to see that.
Absolutely. And I just looked at the Grizzlies because I can't stand not knowing. And he's not on there because he's retired. But the name came to me. Chandler Parsons. That's who I was talking about.
He got in a bad accident.
Yeah, he was in a car accident. He had injuries just left and right. But, you know, he signed one of those mid-level, like, $84 million deals when he was, you know, he had played well for the Rockets and Mavs. And then the Grizz got stuck with that contract, and the guy never played. It was brutal. But anyway, just not to go off base, I just –
One of those scenarios. You had to figure it out, or you wouldn't have been able to sleep tonight.
It would have really bugged me, yeah.
But, yeah, like I said, I mean, they have some cap room opening up, not a significant amount to where, you know, they might be able to go out and reach and get another all-star or anything like that. But just to kind of, you know, finish it out, I don't think – I like their system that they have right now for the players they have. But I don't truthfully think – with what they have right now, that they will be a contender in the next 3 to 5 years.
Yeah, well, I mean, it depends on those two guys that are now in their 30s, I guess, is really the full question on what's going to happen there. But, you know, I'm not a big D'Antoni guy. I don't think he's a very good coach. I think he's just average. But we'll see.
Yeah, for sure.
Yep. All right, you ready for me to jump into the Thunder here?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right. As we, you know, the point I wanted to make, we've stated their record. They're fifth, but, you know, we don't know where they're going to play the playoffs. If they're going to be in one location or home and away, we have no clue. So, you know, their goal, obviously, if there is home playoff games, is to be able to move up one, at least one spot to get that home court advantage. And they're only one game behind Utah, and they're only 2.5 games behind Denver. And for that matter, they're only four behind the Clippers, who are in second. So, you know, the Thunder have been a phenomenal surprise this year. Everybody assumed this was a, you know, sort of like the Warriors are doing, that this was going to be a year where they're just going to rebuild. They acquired 12 draft picks in the next three or four seasons in getting rid of Westbrook and all the different guys. They picked up Chris Paul, and they were, everything I read, and we talked about a lot on DFS Coach Talk, they were just going to pedal Paul along and be done with it and just build some more draft picks. And there was a lot of talk that Steven Adams was going to hit the road as well. So it would be total rebuild, you know, build around Shea and Gilgeous-Alexander, and they were also going to move Gallinari. So they were literally going to leave the cupboard bare, and then all of a sudden they started winning. And I've been to some games in OKC, and that is an awesome atmosphere to watch a basketball game. It is like a college campus there because they don't have any other sports. It's a smaller town, and Oklahoma City is just – they're great fans. And they've rallied around that team, and now they have become, you know, they feel like they're a contender with Chris Paul's experience and leadership, which he's played out of his mind this year. And Shea's turning into a possible future all-star. Gallinari, Adams has been solid. And, you know, maybe Billy Donovan's best year of coaching, in my opinion. But a team that really was looking like a throwaway year, they've created this situation where they could have a home court round in the playoffs, which is absolutely shocking that nobody expected. So, you know, and how they've done it is pretty interesting. They're not a run-and-gun team. They're 22nd in the league in pace, just at 100.9. So they're, you know, they're setting up some half-court sets and working some plays and slowing down possessions a bit. And then they're following that up with a top 10 defense in the NBA. They're right now 10th. They've sort of wavered between 8th and 11th most of the season. So they're stopping people. So, you know, it's no fun when you come in there and you got Paul shutting people down at the point. Adams, you know, bodying people like crazy in the paint, and even their guys off the bench, some of the young guys, Baisley and Nerlens Noel, and these guys are blocking shots and getting it done. So not, you know, between their pace and their defensive efficiency, they're not a team really to target a ton in matchups. Now, if they're playing a huge pace up team, you know, let's say they're playing you know, somebody like the Rockets or the Pelicans, you know, then you got to really take a serious look, because they are so efficient that if they're, you know, playing in an up-tempo game where you're going to get 6 or 7 or 8 more possessions, some of these guys are very valuable. I mean, Paul, Shea, Gallo and Adams, you know, I've even used Noel when Adams was out because he gets some decent minutes and he's a big blocks guy. So, you know, they become sort of a matchup based team, pretty much. But here's the guy that I haven't mentioned yet. And this, I won't quiz you, on this one, because I don't think you're going to get it, but the guy I haven't mentioned yet leads their team in usage is Dennis Schroeder. And no one would believe that. You'd think, okay, just like I just said, Chris Paul, Shea, it's Dennis Schroeder, 27.2% usage off the bench. He's played in 63 games and started only one. So when he comes in, he is gunning, scoring, shooting. And, you know, that's a fantastic guy. Under the radar at a decent price that is very usable. And I did not realize that he had jumped past some of these guys in usage. So definitely a guy to look at. Gallinari at 24.4, Shea at 23.7, and Paul at 23.2. So they're all right there together. Even if you look at all four of those guys, you're talking about four decent percentages of usage between 23 and 27. They've bought in, they're sharing the ball, and on a given night, they're all very effective. Now, here's something though that will surprise you a little bit, I think. This is where your quiz comes in, man. What do you think the usage is for Steven Adams? Because he's frequently makes a lot of lineups because he's a cheap center. What do you think his usage is for the Thunder this year? You're on mute, I bet.
I'd say around 14%.
That's a good guess, 17%. But he's a guy that's generally spent a lot of his career in the 20s. So it's definitely surprising he's taken a little bit of a fall off there. But there was a time where when we thought they were still going to blow it up at the beginning of the season, that he was not factoring in as much and getting rested more for Noel, because it seemed as though Noel was the heir apparent to his job and they were sort of transitioning that. But surprise, surprise. I mean, I think they even surprised themselves. So not only are they a playoff team this year, which is pretty amazing, and because they're already definitely going to make the playoffs, And it's, they may get a home court advantage in the playoffs for the first round, but they have all these picks. They have a ton of picks, more than anybody else in the league over the next 3 or 4 years. So, you know, can they use those picks to build a stronger team and be fantastic down the road? Or are a lot of those picks going to go to waste? You know, we remember the Celtics very short time ago had so many picks that Danny Ainge put together from, you know, and some of those were used fantastic, you know, for them, you know, the ones especially they got for the Nets for Garnett and Pierce. But a lot of those second rounders and, you know, late first rounders and things sort of almost went to waste. They basically traded them away for nothing because they could not roster that many young guys. So it all comes down to how is their front office going to handle it, and you know, where they're going to go from there. But again, you know, a good team to be a fan of, because not only are they winning now, but based on all the draft picks and everything they have, they could definitely win in the future. So that, you know, that is one big, you know, one good thing to look forward to as they're going forward. But you know, playoff matchups are going to be key for them. I mean, you know, there are teams much more talented if you really look at top to bottom on some of these rosters. But the bottom line is they're scrappy and they're tough at home and their defense is good. So the teams like the Denvers and Dallas and all these other teams that may play them, I don't think they really want to play them. I think that teams are a little bit afraid. Even you, I bet you if you really ask LeBron, you know, he's not thrilled about going against a Chris Paul-led team in the playoffs just because of the experience factor. So, you know, definitely a team to watch. They've been a pleasant story, and I'm really happy that they've done it, because the Thunder fans, you know, they would have stayed with it. They would have done what they needed to do to support the team, even if they had some downtime in the rebuild mode, because they're those kind of fans. But they don't have to. So a rebuild while you're winning is definitely a lot of fun. You know what I'm saying? What do you have anything you want to throw in there before I dig into some of the contracts?
Yeah, I mean, that was a great point there with all the picks they've compiled. And honestly, like you said, you can do two different things with those. You can really build up your team in a nice way, or you can just dish them out and, you know, waste them. So I think with that many picks, you almost have to make a splash in free agency this year and go after, you know, maybe trade up in the draft and get somebody talented. I know that Obi Toppin, I think that would be a great fit there for them.
Is that three or four spot? From, let's see, he's from where? Dayton? Is that right?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I know a lot of people have talked about him. It seems like there's a lot of guys declaring. I noticed that in the news recently. A real good player from France just declared. So, yeah, the good thing, like you said, about the Thunder, they can target some of those guys because they'll have that flexibility for sure. So very, very interesting, no doubt about it. All right, well, let's look real quickly here. Let's see, where is my contracts part? Here it is, contracts. Thunder. Okay, so we've got Chris Paul, you know, making silly money. He's only making $38 million this year, $41 million next year, and $44 million the following year. Is that nuts or what? So
yeah,
there you go.
Pretty crazy.
I think they definitely will move him eventually. Adams, $25 million this year and $27 million next year. He's also probably going to go. They have a super bargain in Schroeder. He's only making 15.5 this year and 15.5 next year, so they'll hang on to him. The guys that are gone, though, are Gallo's going to be gone. He's a free agent after this year, so he'll hit the road. So is Nerlens Noel, and I guarantee you somebody's going to pay him a hell of a lot more than the $2 million that he made this year to be a young center somewhere. And then, you know, the good news for them is they've got Shea on that rookie deal where he makes 3.9, 4.1, and then team option to pick up for 5.4. So he's locked down for the next three seasons. He'll be fine. But they've tried to sign some of their young guys. They Darius Bazley, they have offered, and he accepted a four-year deal, which is a lot for a guy that you don't know is going to make it. And then they traded for Isaiah Roby from the Mavs, who was their first-round pick. He's 22 years old, and they signed him to a four-year deal. So they're trying to build with some young talent, and I think with the picks that they have coming, and then with more than likely moving these guys, because I can't imagine that they want to keep Chris Paul at that salary, and I don't believe that they want to try to build around a Danilo Gallinari at 31 years old. So expect a lot of movement from that team, but what a fine future with some of those young guys with Shea at 21, and you know, they have Diallo, Hamidou Diallo's 21. He's got some talent. Devontae Burton. They've got a lot of young guys. So I think the transitional year from them may be next year when they really, you know, they'll take a run at it this playoffs, if there is one, and then next year move those guys and then start retooling for the future. That's what it seems like to me.
Yeah, you got to think that, you know, that's definitely a possibility. They also have Justin Patton. He's a real young center. Yes. He's looked pretty promising, too. So, I mean, with the possibility of moving Steven Adams or Nerlens Noel, you know you have that there. But, yeah, you got to wonder if maybe
you know where Justin Patton, you know where Justin Patton is?
I do not.
Dallas Mavericks, bro. They traded Isaiah Roby for Justin Patton. And that'll be a guy, what a great lead-in, because I will be interviewing on our show here a real close friend of mine who is the president of the D-League, G-League, I'm sorry, Texas Legends, really right-hand man to Donnie Nelson with the Mavericks, and that's Malcolm Farmer. And when I talked with him here last week to set up the interview and everything, he was talking about Justin Patton, because I think he's going to be the Legends' best player next year. They have Cameron Payne right now that's a real stud, and he's been trying to make the league again. But, yeah, Justin Patton is a kid that the Thunder gave up on for some reason, and hopefully he'll turn into a good Maverick.
Yeah, for sure. Like I said, I was not aware that that was the trade right there, so my apologies there. But, yeah, I mean, they, like you explained, they have some young talent already, and you got to wonder, you know, maybe they try moving Chris Paul's big contract to one of his buddies. Maybe play a couple years with LeBron, or play a couple years with, you know, one of his buddies that he's been wanting to play with his whole
career.
Not at
that contract, dude. There's no way. He's cornered himself into not being able to do that, though. I mean, nobody can absorb 38, 41, and $44 million over the next 3 years if you have, you know, if you're the Lakers. I mean, and he can't. He's the head of the Players Association. He's not going to take a buyout or pay decrease. I mean, because that sets an example to the rest of them. So I think personally, I think Paul finishes out his career with a team that's just an average team, wherever they can move him to, of somebody that's on the brink of maybe just making the playoffs or needs, you know, a veteran point guard, because of the salary. So anyway, for what it's worth.
Yeah,
but
no, exactly.
I do want to say this. I think the Thunder are not a team I'm going to target the rest of the season based on their defensive prowess, their pace, etc. However, because, like I mentioned, they're only 4.5 games out of second, and, you know, they still could slip down and not get a home court playoff thing, they're going to come out gunning and needing to play well in order to keep their position in the playoff hunt. So, you know, if it's a good matchup, I'd say go for it. You know, like, you know, I always play point guards against the Cavaliers. If they're playing the Cavaliers, I'm going to take Chris Paul. I mean, he's put up the numbers. He's one of the top five guys in points down the stretch in the last 5 minutes of a game. even at 34, he's doing that. So he and LeBron at 36 and 34 are two of the top five scorers in the last minutes of an NBA basketball game. That goes to show you that, yes, young legs and talent like that is important, but having the brains and experience on the floor is amazing. And I'll tell you, for the guys that are just getting into DFS and know Chris Paul now, if you'd have known and watched him 10 years ago, the dude would, every game, 11 assists, no turnovers, 10 assists, one turnover. He's, you know, that he has the best turnover to assist ratio in the history of the NBA. He even moved ahead of John Stockton. So that tells you the kind of fantastic player he is. And people forget, he was the starting point guard on those teams that kicked ass for us in the Olympics with LeBron and Kobe and everybody. He was the quarterback of those teams. So he gets overlooked, especially at his older age now. And maybe because he does all those State Farm commercials, people hate him. But I don't know, man. But anyway, that's the story with the Thunder. You know, definitely tune in to us. Check us out at DFSCoachTalk.com. Check us on Twitter at DFSCoachTalk. If you have any questions, comments, you want to throw something in the mix, we can bring on a future pod. My Twitter is at Joe Sarvadi. That's J-O-E-S-A-R-V-A-D-I. And I'll throw it to you to give your Twitter handle. And don't be like Santino and misspell your own name.
I think I got this one. It's at DFS_LAYTON. So that's at DFS_Layton.
Excellent. And our other pros too, at Mike Apotria, MikeApotria. And our man Andrew is at Language Olympic. You can listen to us 7 days a week. We talked about it earlier. We're going to do a podcast and a meaningful podcast every day until sports return. We're going to dig deeper than anybody could imagine to figure out the best DFS plays in the NBA. Then we're going to transition into Major League Baseball and then into the NFL. So we're going to have our three sports just dug into, sliced and diced until we figure out every moving part of every team. Then we're going to finish off, if sports has not returned back, with some mock drafts that will be a blast, that will give us an opportunity to look at that side of it for who's going to do well DFS-wise from our experts. So that all in preparation for, again, when we get back and we can make some big money, take down some big tournaments, and make sure we win all those 50-50s and head-to-heads. We do ask you, when you're catching us on these podcasts, which you can listen to on iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, Podbean, iHeart, Spotify, YouTube, and basically everywhere podcasts are found, that you take a second and rate, review, and subscribe. We're having a drawing this evening, our monthly drawing. It's a Sunday, the first Sunday of every month. We have a drawing for a free one-month membership for anybody during that month that gave us 5 stars on iTunes and put a comment. So Layton and I will do that and get that done prior to this Monday podcast coming out. So we'll announce the winner Sunday evening in our Discord, and then Monday this podcast will come out, and you guys can start fresh for a new month of making that comment and giving us 5 stars. Also, you know, the key thing is subscribing, because we put these videos these podcasts out, you know, different times between like 11 and 2 each day, somewhere in there. And we try to just keep it a little bit moving spot. But if you want to know right when it comes out so you can listen to it, if you subscribe, you know, click that little bell on YouTube, it'll give you an indication right when it posts. And if you want to join us, I mean, jump in. You know, our memberships are frozen until sports begin again. So if you join in, you know, even if it's a week membership, you just ride us out this next couple of months or whatever. You're not going to lose any time on that week or whatever you join for. But you get to be in our Discord, get in some of our fun contests, talk a lot of sports, and just dig in and get ready, because that's exactly what we're doing here. So We appreciate that. Also, continue to support our favorite charity, which is mambaonthree.org. That's mambaonthree.org. Just a wonderful charity that still needs help. And with this COVID-19 thing going, it's sort of gotten lost in the shuffle. So please give there if you can. And that's pretty much it, man. Any last words to our members and listeners out there, Layton?
Oh, well, first to you again, thanks for letting me join the podcast. I've been having a lot of fun with them. This is my second one on the books now, and then I'm really looking forward to the baseball ones. That's kind of my bread and butter, so I'm ready to dive into those and get to look at a couple cool teams over there. And then, again, we have a lot of fun in our Discord. We just started, actually, what was that, yesterday, Coach? We had MLB and NBA challenge.
Yeah.
So that was super fun to kind of see our members and, of course, our pros dive into those slates. So, again, if you want to join the fun, DFSCoachTalk.com, and get in there and let's get it going.
Absolutely, man. And shout out to S. Caldwell. He has the Detroit Lions logo in our chats, but he uses our DFS Coach Talk badge on FanDuel. But have you? I can't get over this dude and how awesome he is at these simulations. I think he's. I mean, I don't know how he's figuring it out, but I'm telling you guys, you know, we've had like 18, 17 people in some of these little mini contests with baseball and especially basketball, but both. And Mr. S. Caldwell there just keeps racking them up. Can you figure it out?
No, I have no clue. He's definitely got a groove going, because if he's not winning it, he's in the top 3 to 5 every time. So
every time
he's definitely slicing that up.
Well, hey, you know, jump in Discord, check him out, tap into a little Detroit Lions knowledge there. I don't know, you know. If I'd be super proud of fly the Detroit Lions flag, but hey, who am I to say? You can root for whoever you want. But let me tell you this, guy is the king of the sim. That's what I've been calling him on our Discord. I don't even say his name anymore. I just put a crown up there. What does he go by on what's his name on FanDuel? Do you remember? I know you know it. I can't think of it all of a sudden, but it's
Chuck Davey.
Chuck Davey, that's it. Chuck Davey. So keep an eye out for Chuck Davey and our symbol on the sim contest, because I put him up against anybody for real cash. So there you go. All right, man. Good stuff. Great show. Have a great week, guys, and let's just try to keep it on. We got a little while to get through this, and got to all count and work on it together. And we will get there. We're going to come out on the other side, and we are going to be the most prepared people in the industry. I can tell you that much. So thank you so much for joining us for another episode of DFS Coach Talk. For my fellow NBA pros, Micah Patria and Andrew Hansen, and of course, Layton Wilson. I am Coach. We will catch you again tomorrow as we look to prepare to crush it in NBA DFS.
The way to dribble up and down the court, just like I'm the king on the microphone. So it's Dr. J and Moses Malone. I like slam dunks and taking it to the hoop. My favorite play is the